We're out wandering around today and we found a little place to step aside and answer some questions.
Yeah, one of the questions that we get is, why didn't we stop at this place or that place? And there's probably several reasons for that. The first would be that maybe we've already been there and we would rather use our time to see someplace new. Or maybe we did go there and we just didn't put it in the video.
Right. I mean, there's been times when people ask us, why didn't you film this when we went to maybe through the Columbia River Gorge on our way to Yellowstone? And that's because we did another video on the Columbia River Gorge. And sometimes people ask, why didn't we stop at this place or that place on the Oregon coast, or, you know, any particular place? Or, and it's because we've probably been there, like in the case of the Oregon coast, we've been there hundreds of times. And sometimes we do stop at those places. They just don't make it into the video. Yeah. The Oregon coast was like a 4-day thing that we did, and we put it into about 22 minutes. Yeah. So it's
so
a lot of condensing.
There's a lot of places to see, and it could be, you know, time constraints. It could be, you know, budget at the particular time, or
just don't want to.
Just, you know, just is not of interest, or it could be that we just weren't aware of the place. So
yeah,
there's a lot of reasons that you don't see every place that we go through in the videos.
Yeah, definitely. One question that we get that might seem a little strange to some is, how much clothing do we have? But I'm sure it's not just some kind of nosy thing. They just want to know, you know, how many things do we hang on to in an RV? Well, when we had our house, we had a lot.
Because we had three closets full.
Yeah, and you just kind of, when you have that much room, you just kind of put them in the back and you figure, oh, I wore that, you know, in high school, or I wore that, you know, some point of interest or something that you are nostalgic about. So you just kind of stick it in the back of the closet, or we'll make a quilt out of that one day or something. And, you know,
or,
so things
no,
just
I really,
get,
I could wear that at some point. Yeah.
Yeah. So they just keep kind of building up and building up. And, you know, as long as there's a place, it just kind of gets stuffed in there. Well, in the RV, as we all know, you got to be a little bit better about weeding that stuff out, and we did, of course, when we moved into the RV.
Yeah, a lot of clothes.
Like I've said before, this is an ongoing thing. It seems to still be an issue of putting things aside, not wanting to get rid of things. At least for me, I tend to get hats and shirts, I guess, quite a bit. And we started a little rule.
Yeah, the rule is if we get something new, we have to get rid of something old, because our closet is full. It's much smaller than the closet that we had before, but it is full. So if something new comes in, something old has to go out.
Yeah, and a lot of people have that, or talk about the rule, if you don't use something within a year, get rid of it, or maybe 6 months, consider, you know, getting rid of it or something like that. Well, that doesn't really work for us, because there's some things that I might use once a year or something like that. So we just kind of try to do our best, and I think it's more about the allotted space that we have, and we'll look, it's getting a little full, we better reconsider some things, and we're about to do that yet again. And I have a feeling that's going to be an ongoing thing, especially in our closet with clothes. And so, you know, limited amount of space, but we're doing the best that we can. But we could certainly use some more weeding out.
Yeah. So we have enough. I guess that's the answer.
Yeah. Quite a bit.
Someone asked how much crime we've experienced while we've been RVing. And I'd have to say we haven't really experienced any type of violent crime or theft or anything like that. What we've experienced is more along the lines of breaking rules or breaking laws, especially traffic laws.
Yeah, people running red lights constantly at different towns that we go through, probably following too closely, or more often getting in front of you when you have a little bit of space to, you know, a safe amount to stop, that is, and they'll get into that space and clog it up, and you're barreling down on them with your RV, and it's you know, it's those kinds of things. Probably littering is a big thing that we see. We see a lot of lit cigarettes going out the windows, that
see,
kind of thing.
See people not picking up after their dogs. That's kind of one of my pet peeves. I don't mind if your dog has to do his business in our space, but please pick it up. And if you're walking on a trail and you put it in a bag, take it with you until you find a trash can. A lot of people just put it in a bag and leave it on the trail, and I don't get
that. A lot
that.
Of those laying around. So the pollution thing's kind of big, but also another thing along those lines while we're at it is noise pollution. I think that's probably one of the biggest pet peeves for me in the wilderness areas. We've had people blowing air horns, those little canned air horns, out in the wilderness to get other people's attention just as a communication method. We've had, you know, people just talking on their cell phones on speakerphone right when you're watching baby animals nursing, and stuff. I mean, just in wilderness situations. So that gets a little nerve-wracking. Or the big buses at some places along the highways along the coast, especially in California, we experienced that, where they would just idle these big diesel buses, you know, wherever there was a little place to pull off and look at the scenery or the wildlife.
Yeah, and for some reason, motorcycles don't seem to have the same requirements as far as muffler noises as regular cars, because for some reason they just are, some of them are just so loud, and it just gets difficult when you're trying to film, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I've ridden motorcycles and everything, so I don't have anything bad to say about that, but I guess the noise doesn't do anything for me as it does for some people. But anyway, noise pollution is a big thing, and then just other than that, littering and not obeying park or traffic laws and things is probably the biggest. Something we're questioned quite often about is our hitch system. We did do a video some time ago on our truck and hitch system, but this question keeps popping up and understandably so. People want to know how we're getting along with the Anderson hitch that we've been using. And in general, things have been going really well. We've done some updates to it because we wanted to add the chain system. We haven't had any problems that would indicate needing the chain system, but we had an opportunity to get it from the manufacturer, so we took that opportunity. And as I understand, there's some places that would require them, but basically the chain system's just there in the event that it detaches from the hitch ball, that there's a secondary catch there for safety. And so it really doesn't take much to have it on there or to deploy it and use it, so we figured why not have a little bit of redundancy for safety. And but I plan to do a more in-depth video about the hitch in the upcoming future, so watch for that. But in the meantime, I just say it's been pretty good.
I really like the hitch. I'm very happy with it. I love the fact that you can just very easily take it out of the truck if we need the space in the truck.
Very lightweight.
And it's very smooth. I've ridden in other trucks with different types of hitches, and there's just no jerking or jarring. It's just really smooth, and I think it works great.
Yeah, I wouldn't use it if we didn't think it was safe or didn't like it, but it's been going really well so far.
In another video, we talked about some of the critters that you find in the desert Southwest, and we had a few people comment, and maybe it kind of alarmed them. Spooked them a little bit, because we did talk about venomous critters, the rattlesnakes, the scorpions, the
things
black widows,
and
things like that. But we just did that to make people aware. I mean, there's dangerous critters in pretty much anywhere that you visit, and just by making people aware of the things that are in this area and maybe taking a few precautions, it'll help somebody from
encountering
something bad.
Yeah, that's the basic intent with that, is just to spread awareness and get people prepared, because then you're more likely to avoid things going wrong. And like Susan said, these things are everywhere. There's something to consider. So we could just as easily make the case in a lot of other places. to help people be prepared for what might be there. And we have seen these things, but there's also so many that are just adorable.
Yeah.
You know, we like the quail.
Oh, I love the quail, the way they just run in their little lines, and they make these little noises, and they have the little thing on their head.
And and then the jackrabbits and the cottontails, and there's turtles and tortoises.
And lots of rabbits.
Birds everywhere.
Yeah, a lot of birds, hummingbirds, a lot of different kinds of hummingbirds.
It's really quite beautiful in its own way in the Sonoran Desert. The Sonoran Desert tends to be more of a green desert, not to those that have been in the Pacific Northwest or someplace like that. As far as deserts go, it tends to be a little bit more green and teeming with life. So you're definitely going to run into more things of wonder and interest than you will things that scare you off.
Yeah.
We enjoy doing these question and answer videos, so if you have a question, feel free to leave it in the comments section of this video, and we'll do our best to get it into an upcoming video. I'm going to try to get out of here before a dust storm comes up.
Yeah, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.
Thanks for watching.